Ashley Westwood, what a day. Who would have thought, when we looked at the fixtures at 3:30, who would have thought that Colombia and Poland weren't going to end up on the winning side? It's been that kind of a World Cup, and it also shows that the margins are coming down between the established teams, the teams from South America, Europe, and the others, Africa, Asia.
Yeah, it was a strange day. Obviously, two big upsets. Nobody would have called this. I think all the tipsters, all the pundits were all going for Colombia for sure against Japan. But it just shows you that, you know, one incident can turn a game on its head. And that's what happened. And then obviously Colombia was up against it.
Yes, and let's talk about the Japan-Colombia game first up. And you've got to doff your hats at Japan because you didn't expect them to take the game to Colombia. If they hadn't had that attack right at the beginning and you had seen Colombia attacking, you wouldn't have perhaps had that contentious decision. But they took the game and they reaped the rewards.
Yeah, I think it was a bad mistake from the centre defender first. He let the ball slip underneath his foot and then he was trying to recover. All of a sudden he made a hash of his recovery run as well, and then the lad's gone clean through. It was unfortunate for Sanchez that obviously it was a handball, probably intentional, but sometimes your instincts take over and you do stupid things, and after 3 minutes then that was all going to be Japan's way.
Let's talk about that penalty in more detail. You just mentioned what happened, but it just completely throws the coach's game plan right off. It's 3 minutes. It's the second fastest sending off in World Cup history after 1986 when an Uruguayan player got sent off after 54 seconds.
Yeah, it's a strange thing for the mental state, really. Obviously, all the preparation, all your teamwork, all your team shape, opposition analysis, set pieces, everything you want, really. Days, weeks of work just down the pan in three minutes flat. Normally, a good coach will plan for 10 men anyway, but obviously the preparation that you do, it'll almost be thinking, I've done all that for nothing now.
Yes, and 3 minutes gone, fourth minute, start of the game, start of the World Cup campaign. You need an experienced head taking that penalty. And he was very calm, Shinji Kagawa. He shows that he's played at the top level and it showed.
Yeah, I mean, he was cool and calm, obviously very composed. He has a habit of putting him down the middle, to be honest. I think in World Cups we've seen, I think that might be the ninth penalty we've seen in the World Cups.
And seven converted.
And all the goalkeepers are desperate to save him. So sometimes, you know, they opt for a little dink down the middle or even just a little stroke down the middle that you see today. Sometimes works because, like I say, the goalkeepers are thinking, I have to save this. So it takes a brave goalkeeper to stand still and try and read the straight one.
It just leads me back to what happened in the game against Iceland. Almost everyone seems to be getting the penalties right. The two guys who haven't got it are the guy from Peru, Cueva, and Lionel Messi.
Yeah, I mean,
This is something which is going to be...
The Cueva one was unbelievable. I think that ball's still travelling. He's managed to send that one over the stand almost. And then Messi's, he's hit it well, but it was a good height for the goalkeeper, and you don't expect Messi to miss them.
Okay, big player going off, central midfielder, perhaps someone who sits back. But credit to Colombia, that while they did look rattled initially, they found their way back into the game. They really came back strongly towards after about 20 minutes.
Yeah, it took them a few minutes to adjust. I think Corrado was the one who got sacrificed in the end. He's an attacking right winger and he was getting caught high up the field. So they were getting in down the left-hand side, Colombia's right. And he managed to make a substitution. He put Barrios on, which is a tough tackling, tenacious midfielder to go in. He likes to rat and press the ball. And it paid dividends, and it was all about the shape, really.
Yes, and I think you should show it to us on your tactical board, Ashley, because you think, you know, you look back at sides who have lost a player early on, they changed their entire shape. He didn't change his shape. For 30 minutes he went with the same team at his disposal, 10 men against 11, but somehow they found a way of taking the fight back to the Japanese.
Yeah, I mean, they both started on a 4-2-3-1, which we anticipated. But then, obviously, after the sending off, you see Colombia, they went back into this position here. And it was all about, you know, four central midfielders really keeping it nice and tight. That was the key. But it wasn't just that. It was the way there wasn't too much space between both units. But it's the way they pressed the ball as well. You know, if we take the ball, for example, and we move it over to these kind of positions, which is what you see, you know, the nearest man would go and press the ball. And then all of a sudden, if the ball was moved again, it's basic stuff, really. The man would retreat back into the position he's came from. And then the next man was going. So it was quite high press. For 10 men, it was fairly high press. What you sometimes do is you see teams sit back in two banks of four, but they let the Japanese have the ball. And that didn't happen. You know, like I say, it was all about how they moved. You know, if the ball was to travel there, then everybody would shuffle across and get up the pitch. And so with the back four, and they made the spaces as minimal as possible, and trying to put pressure on the ball, which was key. So Japan couldn't settle too much, and that's why Colombia managed to get a goal back, 1-1, make a game of it. But I think second half, they retreated a bit too deep. They left Falcao really isolated up the top, and they were trying to fire long balls into Falcao, and they couldn't find him. So Falcao couldn't receive the ball, so it just kept coming back. And after a matter of time, more pressure, cumulative pressure, you're going to concede one.
And they are going to tire after all that running which they had to do. But that equaliser, talk to me about it, because when I saw the replays, I wasn't convinced that it was intentional that he slipped the ball under the wall. It looked like he scuffed it, perhaps.
Yeah, I was adamant that he didn't mean that. You know, I've seen a few programmes across the day, different ones, even in different countries, and a lot of the pundits are saying, oh, he meant it. You know, they must have done opposition analysis. They knew the wall was going to jump. They probably did know the wall was going to jump, but there's no way he meant that. If you looked at it from behind, for me, his standing foot slipped a little bit. He scuffed across it with his left foot, and it was the speed on the ball. If he meant it, there would have been a lot more pace on the ball, and it's almost trickled in. Obviously, it was, you know, blindsided. The goalkeeper's gone under the wall, but like I say, if you mean to go under the wall, you'll hit that ball a lot harder than he did, and for me, it was a very lucky goal.
Okay, so you're the Japanese coach. You have 1-1 at half-time. You have the opposition team down to 10 men. They've played with 10 men for around 42, 43, 44 minutes, including at a time. What would his message be to his team? You know, keep at it, stretch them, tire them out, knowing that towards the end that's going to count.
I think you try and keep the ball, you try and move them around, you know, use the full width of the pitch, you know, knock it from the left back, rotate it back through your central defenders into midfield. And the more you can move them around, the more you can tire the Colombians. What you don't want is them just sitting off, just, you know, regimented in front of the back four. So you need to move the ball side to side and in, out, back, all the way around the pitch, and eventually you'll catch somebody out of a hole and you'll find an advantage. That sounds all good on paper, and it was actually a set piece in the end that the Japanese scored off. And
were you surprised with that goal? Because, you know, that was a phase in the game which could have gone either way. Immediately after that, Colombia had a couple of shots as well. James had come in by then. But it's a crowded penalty box. Your back's against the wall. The three guys going for it, and yet Yayu heads the ball into the goal.
Well, I spoke before the game and the earlier show saying that Colombia would have too much for the Japanese from set pieces, because the Japanese aren't the biggest side. And I think that was the first time Japan have scored from a corner in a World Cup. So that shows you how rare it is. You know, they don't score headed goals from corners. And there's two things, really. The goalkeeper possibly could have maybe come for it because it was only about 4 yards out. But the lads leaped. The right back, I think, was Arias, was the man who was marking him, and he just didn't get off the ground. Let his man jump. He didn't contest the ball too well, and he just got outpowered. It was a great finish, a great header off the far post. But you don't expect to get done from a set piece. You know, certainly you've battled all day with 10 men. You'll be kicking yourselves.
Yes, they will be. And I think the final word on Japan, because 2010 they reached the round of 16. They actually had a good World Cup. They had two wins and beat Denmark as well, 3-1. This is the first win for them at a World Cup since that match. They will be absolutely flying, the Samurai Blues.
Yeah, they will be. And they, you know, they rested a couple of players as well. Osaka, the forward from Leicester, was on the bench. Honda was also on the bench. So they've still got a little bit more to give, possibly. And obviously they changed the coach 2 months ago. They asked for a more attacking coach. It looks like he's given them that today, and they'll be happy now, nice and confident, and they'll probably get a little bit stronger.